everyone. We're going to kick off now. Just to let you know, we have an online audience as well as the in-person audience here today. So thank you to everyone collectively for joining us for the launch of our employability report. The report was published this morning. Any eager beavers might have read it already, although there's quite a lot of content to get through. So hopefully this summary event today will be relatively new information for people. The report follows a consultation exercise that TASO undertook and published last year. So following feedback from the sector, we launched a whole strand of work focused on reducing inequalities in employment and employability. And this is the first output from that project. It's a gaps analysis piece of work where we sought to understand both what challenges the HE sector were facing in terms of what the kind of largest inequality gaps are in graduate outcomes post-HE and what they're currently doing to address those challenges, with a particular focus on what works and type 3 evidence. It's worth noting that for this initial exercise, we focused exclusively on the activities that were happening within HE providers, within universities. So we haven't looked at interventions that employers are conducting to improve outcomes for graduates, although that might be something that we do in future. So just to kind of be aware of the parameters of the of that, which will kind of influence what we share today. And we also have a kind of key focus on causal evidence, trying to understand what causal evidence exists and what TASO could do in future to kind of build causal evidence to reduce inequality gaps in employment outcomes. So off the back of this report, we will be seeking to do our own primary research and evaluation, which we will continue to share as it comes out. But for now, I will hand over to Baz from the Centre for Education and Youth, who conducted the gap analysis, who produced the gap analysis report for us.
Thanks, Jess, and morning, everyone. So my name's Baz. I am a senior associate at the Centre for Education and Youth, and along with David Robinson at the Education Policy Institute, we were the co-authors on this report. And in that context, I'm going to say a little bit more about the wider background that prompted this research and also the methodology we've deployed as part of this work. So the context undergirding this work is that the labour market has changed substantially in recent years. The proportion of higher education graduates entering the labour market as new entrants has massively increased, and the proportion of those new entrants who are from non-traditional, disadvantaged, widening participation backgrounds has also increased massively. And of course, given recent changes under COVID, a lot of graduates entering the labour market face significant challenges. And we had this ambient sense from the wider sector, partly from TASO's previous work, that although there's this groundswell of interest in trying to improve outcomes for these young people from disadvantaged backgrounds in the labour market, there's not necessarily a lot of high quality evidence out there on what works to improve those outcomes. So TASO, naturally, as the emerging What Works Centre for Higher Education, we're passionate about changing this issue, building that evidence base, understanding where those gaps are. And us at the Centre for Education and Youth, all of our research is oriented around a very simple theme, which is providing the knowledge that society needs to ensure that all young people make a fulfilling transition to adulthood. Now, given that graduating and going into your first job after graduating is probably one of the key junctures in which one transitions into adulthood, we were clearly very passionate to understand this issue in greater detail, and particularly where the gaps are in the research, where more work needs to be done. So in pursuit of this goal, we deployed a mixed methods methodology in which we drew on data analysis, literature review, and also a sector consultation. I'll say a little bit more about each of these methods very briefly. So, on here. Is there something I'm doing wrong? Oh, is the TV frozen? Is it a freeze screen? Unfreeze. Okay.
try disconnecting it and reconnecting it, Jess?
What, this? Why? Yeah. Oh, is this what Frankie said?
Mm. She said it can turn off sometimes. So.
Should show that. Yeah. Sorry about that, everyone. Thank you for sorting that out, Jess. So as I say, three research methods that sum together to create our overall methodology: data analysis, literature review, and sector consultation. I'll say a little bit more about each of these in turn to give you a sense of how we delivered this work. So to explore gaps in outcomes between different groups of graduates, so getting a sense of the context here, what are the magnitude and character of gaps between disadvantaged groups and non-disadvantaged groups in the labour market, but also between different types of disadvantaged groups. We conducted a data analysis that was led by my colleague David Robinson at the Education Policy Institute. And this was work using two primary data sets, the LEO data set and also the HESA Graduate Outcome Survey data set as well. Both very powerful data sets. So descriptive analysis of both of these sets, guided by those two research questions: what are the gaps and what's the magnitude and character of them? But also a secondary question, which is what are the drivers of some of these gaps? In order to offer some tentative answers there, David actually did a bit of a literature review as well to support this analysis and understanding what some of the mechanisms are there driving these gaps. Of course, like any research and like any work with any data set, there are of course limitations to this work, and both LEO and HESA have omissions for part-time work and unemployment. They don't record that data. So there might be some skew in the earnings gaps for some demographics, but wherever possible in the report, we've tried to capture that in our exegesis and our explanation of our analysis. So data analysis is one strand of what we did. That provides the context. We also did a literature review on what are the programs that are being run by higher education providers and what's the evidence suggesting that they work. To do this, we ran a structured literature review with keyword search and syntax search on ERIC, the online database. And using a gradual process of searching and sifting, we found 35 papers that met our selection criteria. Using the TESO taxonomy of the kind of quality and character of these studies, 23 of these studies were empirical studies, 10 were narrative, and 2 were causal. It was very noticeable that as part of our literature review, I suppose we ended up identifying and reproducing a lot of the challenges that prompted the work in the first place, which is this kind of lacuna, this gap in the research for those high quality studies. In line with that, nearly all of the studies that we found were providing emerging evidence rather than medium strength or strong evidence, and just under a third of those studies looked at disadvantaged groups specifically in a stratified way with a sufficient sample size to generate any strong conclusions. And the final strand of our research methodology was a sector consultation. We went out to the sector and we recruited 27 practitioners and experts working on careers and employability programs in higher education providers. And we invited them to participate in a focus group. And at the start of that focus group, they completed a short survey in a captive audience format. We also disseminated the survey to some people who weren't able to attend the focus group. And from that consultation process, we got some descriptive data from the surveys, for example, on what interventions universities are running and other higher education providers are running, what their experiences of delivering them, the challenges, how they evaluate them, how much they invest in them, these kinds of high-level bits of descriptive data. But we also got a lot of kind of narrative accounts from individuals working in higher education providers on careers and employability, particularly for disadvantaged young people. And that also was transcribed, and we conducted a thematic analysis on that. And all of this was synthesized to produce our output on what the sector thinks about delivering this kind of work. So what did we find? Well, I'm going to hand it over to Zara from TESO, who's going to tell us a little bit more about our findings.
Hello, everyone. So my name is Zara Boudawi, and I'm a research officer at TESO. So I've been working on this report. Do you have the speaker notes? So first of all, talking about the data analysis part, EBI looked at the gaps in graduate earnings, and we see that they emerge immediately after graduation and they increase further over time. So 1 year after graduation, we identify a £11,300 gap between the lower quartile and the higher one. 10 years after graduation, this gap had increased to £24,100. And we can see that there were significant differences according to the subject that was studied and also the university that was attended. And we also identify earning gaps between different ethnic groups and different students who come from different UK regions. And many of these gaps widen 10 years following graduation, and we don't have data beyond that, but we imagine it continues to widen. We looked specifically at the trajectory of the gender earning gap. We saw that in the year following graduation, male graduates earn 8% more than the female peer. And in the following 9 years, the gap grows to 32%. So we looked at what could be the drivers of this gap. And we noticed that initially it seems to be driven by subject choices. But later on, there are other factors such as parenting responsibilities, the number of hours worked, the propensity to ask for pay rises and apply for promotion, or also labor market discrimination that seem to have an impact. So when it comes to the evidence synthesis part of our work, we looked at a number of different types of interventions, the first one being the evidence on work experience. So work experience we define as a range of intervention that provides students with exposure to the industry and employment. So that includes internships, sandwich courses, but also part-time jobs. As you can see, yeah, we found 12 pieces of research, which is quite a lot compared to the other type of interventions. What we concluded from that evidence is that multiple smaller work experience opportunities that are distributed throughout a course are more beneficial than having larger single blocks of experience. However, it can be useful to place students with employers who seek long-term hires, because that can enable students to find employment at the placement organization afterwards. And graduates need to be supported so that they can clearly communicate the value of their work experience. Unfortunately, we didn't find any research that was focused on encouraging students to pursue work experience, which would be interesting given that it seems to have very, very good impact. Now looking at information, advice, and guidance. So this corresponds to the provision of resources to students so that they can understand the career options and make more effective decisions around them. So for that, we found 8 pieces of research. So IAG can take different forms. It can consist in career counseling, talks, seminars, or workshops. And it can be offered through documents, website, or online tools. We found multiple papers supporting the efficiency of IAG for improving employment and employability outcomes. Some of the papers we found concluded that IAG was associated with higher earnings and job satisfaction 5 years after graduation, increased knowledge and readiness for the job market, and also progression of disadvantaged students into postgraduate education. Now moving on to technology-based interventions. So we looked at 4 kinds of innovative technology-based interventions for employment and employability outcomes. And we found 5 pieces of research. So most of these interventions come early in their life cycle. First of all, we looked at work simulations. So it's where there is a virtual environment that is created and that allows students to acquire skills that otherwise they would gain through work experience. We also looked at commercially available video games, as we saw that they could improve students' employability skills. e-portfolio can help mature students show rather than tell their achievements and their experiences to employers. And finally, automated CV analyzers can be useful because they allow quality feedbacks on CV to be given at a larger scale than if it was only done by the academics. We looked at evidence on teaching employability skills. So we define employability skills as a range of competencies that are deemed necessary for success in securing and retaining employment. And we found 5 pieces of research on that topic. The evidence indicates that these skills can be honed through higher education. For example, offering sports and volunteering opportunities appears to help HE students to develop these employability skills. But evidence suggests that the explicit teaching of these skills may not be effective at improving career and employment outcomes for students. However, if we look at subject-specific employability skills, there is evidence that they could be effective, but we are missing high-quality evidence on that topic. And interventions delivered by higher education providers may be effective at modifying psychological competencies that are associated with positive career and employment outcomes. Finally, we looked at some evidence on general interventions that are targeted at specific disadvantaged groups and also some delivery considerations. So there was a stakeholder consultation with students with autism, and they state that they prefer work experience in preparation for the working world, but they express concern that employers might be hesitant to take them because of their disability. So they want education providers to build strong partnerships with employers so that they can communicate their skills and value to those employers. It appears that a combination of work experience and job simulation is effective to improve the employability and employment outcomes of these students. Unfortunately, we found little evidence on improving the employability of students with physical disability, but the evidence that we found suggests that they could potentially be supported through job simulation training, so something we talked about before. Now moving on to the sector consultation. So as Bad said, we consulted a number of stakeholders, and we found that the disadvantaged groups that are most likely to be targeted by career interventions are the learners who are BME, care leavers, disabled students, and students from low socioeconomic status background. And we found that targeting is often conducted in conjunction with WP teams at a provider level, but some providers also use a data-driven approach. And several providers express an interest or commitment in offering universal provision that is accessible to disadvantaged students, but not only. So this is due to different concerns, ensuring equal opportunities for students, avoiding stigma, and also low uptake for targeted programs. So some providers already deliver mandatory career programs for all students, or they fold provision into the wider academic curriculum. When they are conducting targeted interventions for disadvantaged groups, these interventions tend to be work experience, employability skills workshop, or also information, advice, and guidance. But less than half of the number of students who are eligible to participate in targeted information do so, which is in line with the uptake among the wider student population. So that explains in part why providers would want to make programs more accessible to every student, not just disadvantaged groups. So when they try to decide which program they want to offer for employability and career, providers draw on a wide range of information sources. So they look at the literature, they look at previous programs, and they also try to listen to student voices. Providers say that they are confident in their knowledge of what works, but they are aware that many factors that play into students' outcome, students' employability remain beyond their control. And also, they evaluate the provision of programs using student feedback, employment outcomes data, and case studies. However, data collection after graduation remains a major challenge. So it's difficult for providers to capture data on concrete employment outcomes that can be associated with the participation in a particular program. And during the pandemic recently, providers adopted different practices, such as remote provision, which may be beneficial for some group of disadvantaged students. So finally, we gathered some recommendations for higher education providers. First of all, we recommend that these providers adopt a strategic approach to career and employability provision that begins with a theory of change. We recommend that they develop and evaluate employment and careers program specifically targeted at reducing the gaps that we saw in the first part of the presentation in employment outcome. And we also recommend closer relationship between WP, diversity and inclusion teams, and career services, because we believe that it could improve the identification and the targeting of those programs. We recommend that providers develop robust evidence on the impact of the following interventions, so work experience, information, advice, and guidance, specifically when looking at and alumni and peer mentoring opportunities. And we recommend that they invest in training and evaluating innovative technology-based approaches and also approaches to support the uptake and participation in career and employability services amongst disadvantaged students. Finally, we recommend that they involve disadvantaged students in the production process and that they include cost-benefit analysis when possible. When providers prefer undertaking universal provision, they should seek to ensure that they gather data on the social background of their participants so that they can assess whether the programs can actually tackle the equality gaps. We recommend that they run robust trials of different career and employability programs, if possible, across multiple providers. That way we can develop the what work evidence base, and we increase the rigor of the investigation by allowing a larger number of data to be captured. And finally, we support the collective learning across the higher education sector on what works by encouraging providers to share new and emerging evidence. So thank you. And now we're going to move on to the panel.
Thank you, Zara. I should have said at the start that if you have any questions throughout, particularly to the online audience, please drop them in the Q&A box. We will have about half an hour at the end to take any questions from both our in-person and virtual audiences. We're now going to have a panel discussion. So we have two panel members who are joining us today who will each present for about 10 minutes, and then we'll kind of open conversation to the floor and have a kind of free-ranging conversation. So our first panelist is Stephen Isherwood, who is the chief exec from the Institute for Student Employers. There we go.
Thanks very much. Just put that on presenter mode. Hold on. I've got it. Yeah. Cool. There we go. Fantastic. So my name's Steve Isherwood. I lead an organisation called the Institute of Student Employers. If you don't know who we are, we're a members organisation. So we represent structured employers of early talent. So what does that mean? That means people that run things like graduate programmes. So we tend to be the larger size employers. If you don't have somebody who's an early talent hiring manager, development manager, you can use our services. And I say that because that does... That explains where our data comes from. So it's not really based on the SME market. I use the word early talent, not just graduates. We used to be called the Association of Graduate Recruiters. That's because most employers now actually think about early talent, not just graduates, school leavers, apprentice programs, and sort of various iterations in between, which has changed the nature of what we do over the last sort of five to 10 years. But we're not just employers, we've got about 90 universities that are members, about 140 schools, and also suppliers to the industry. So my job, as I understand it this morning, hopefully, is to give you, I guess, an input from the employer lens in terms of what are employers doing about diversity and equality when it comes to actually, you know, the hiring of people and progressing them through to those early stages of their career. So the first thing I want to highlight is where are employers focusing on now? And this has changed. I've been in this role for 9 years. Before this job, I used to run student recruitment for EY. Before that was PwC. And when I look at a piece of data like this, actually 10 years ago, this was completely different. Gender would have been top of the list. Actually, only would have had about four characteristics that employers would have been focused on. So the range of characteristics that employers look at when they're targeting groups to hire has grown significantly. But also what has changed, I guess, is the order of priority. Black Lives Matter has had a significant impact on the proportion of employers really focusing on race. Like I said, that used to be just behind gender. But socioeconomic background, social mobility, 10 years ago, less than 20% of employers would actually say they were doing anything about social mobility at all. This is the proportion of organisations that say where they really need to take action, but the actual percentage of organisations doing something in the social mobility space is around about 80-85%. So significant growth in employers looking at this issue. A little comment on language. Employers talk about social mobility. So if you say to employers widening participation, they might give you a bit of a blank look. So sometimes language gets in the way slightly, but that's what we're talking about here when it comes to employer activities. This data is pre-pandemic data, but I think it's quite a useful way of looking at actually, I think, some of the challenges that are still out there when it comes to actually who gets the jobs that we're talking about. So we did some data having a look at actually who do employers hire, and how does that correlate to both the UK population and actually the higher education population. I do caveat this a little bit. The number of employers that gave us this data was just over 100, so it's a relatively small pool compared to the number of employers out there. And there's a little bit of bias in terms of actually those that were given us data, those that actually collate it. There's still a chunk of employers that don't collate this data. So, but bearing in mind those caveats, I think it's quite interesting looking at what happens through the selection process, because exactly like Taysa, we're very interested in what the data shows, what's actually really happening on the ground beyond all the fine words and the programs that are out there. So if we go to first generation graduates, those who attended a state school, actually what you see is the proportion of hires is still significantly below actually what the UK population averages or the average of students actually within higher education. I do think our sample is slightly biased because law firms are a big part of our membership. You know, the big accountancy firms, the big city firms are in there. When I compare our data to the broader HESA data, I think there's a little bit of a skew in there. There's another piece of data actually that goes behind this, and that's what happens through the selection process. Because actually, if I talk about gender, female students, they may be underrepresented on graduate programs, but if they apply for a graduate program, they are more likely to get a job offer. As they go through the selection process, actually, women are more likely to be successful than their male counterparts. So that says to me, when it comes to gender, actually, the issue is around attraction. Who wants to apply to these roles? Are these roles right? All the kind of issues around that. When actually I look at that data for social mobility candidates, actually the opposite happens. And I don't really know why. We need to do a lot more work on this. But actually candidates, first generation university, state school candidates, also the same applies to ethnicity, slightly less likely to get through the selection process. And as I said, it's a little bit difficult to explore why that is, because it'd be different for different organisations. But that suggests that there's something in the selection process that is weeding people out. And I know a lot of employers that we work with are doing more to try to understand that. Is it, for example, testing processes are biased? Is it the actual interview and assessment centre process that's biased? And I know when I talk to employers, actually they're still finding it a little bit difficult to understand where that is, but the data tells a story in itself, so there's still a job there that needs to be done. One of the most effective things that employers do, they tell us, and it relates to some of the stuff that we've heard already, around those interventions that actually make a difference. And it's the targeting of specific groups, and it's the actual doing programs with them. So the kind of activities that employers do, it will be things like insight days, work experience weeks, spring weeks. Lots of employers run actual programs exclusively for individuals from more diverse backgrounds. And as we heard in the earlier presentation, actually those programs very often lead to real jobs and real work. They are a stepping stone. So you'll see here where employers tend to focus those programs. And again, the order is slightly different here. So a lot of those programs are being developed by candidates from a widening participation background. And when we look at employers and the work we do, those are the ones that tend to be most effective. So as the report showed this morning, those interventions that involve real work, involve change, involve giving people the experience of work, when those are tied to actual real jobs that people will do once they graduate, that's where there's a lot of effective work being done. I think it's worth talking a little bit around the way the graduate recruitment market works, particularly in the UK, because it is quite different to other countries around the world. A stat I quote very often, if you've heard me speak before, I've repeated this ad nauseum. Over 86% of employers do not recruit by subject discipline. What you study is not necessarily restrictive in terms of what jobs you may apply for. So you talk to the law firms, you talk to the accountancy firms, 40-50% of the intakes might have a degree that is not relevant to the actual field of work that you're doing. If you pause for a minute, that's very different to other countries. In Europe, you cannot be a lawyer without a law degree. In the States, if you don't do a Bachelor of Commerce degree, you cannot go and be an accountant. Simple as that. You'd have to go right back and start your education course again. And that's the same for lots of roles in the UK. So in some ways, that's very good, because actually it gives students a huge amount of choice in terms of career. But of course, with choice, you can get paralysis of choice. And it's also worth thinking about what that means for attraction processes, the marketing activities that employers undertake. So employers will target an entire campus, not just an individual course. So in terms of sophistication of employers in the UK, actually it's quite a bit more advanced than other countries. And what that also means in this country is that the attraction piece is generally divorced from the selection piece. So where an employer targets, and that can be quite different to actually where people can apply from. Again, that's quite different to other territories. If I look at the US, for example, employers will target a specific institution, a specific course, and they will try to get the best students from that course. And they won't necessarily invite applications from other courses, and where the UK is much more open. Now, of course, this will take us up on a whole other tangent. We could talk about this all morning. That leads to prioritisation of certain campuses, the whole debate around actually are employers a bit too elitist about the campuses they go to, how does that all work, etc., etc. I'll come back to that just in a second to close off. But this has driven a lot of employer practices, and I think there's a lot more employers that still need to do this. This is the percentage of employers that are actually using these activities, so there's still some way to go. But things like name blind screening, university blind applications, using contextualized data, coaching candidates face to face from more diverse backgrounds, doing some of that stuff digitally. These are all things employers tell us are starting to make a difference. So I think we need to do more to get more employers doing this. Interestingly, the use of UCAS points as a screen out has reduced significantly over time. It varies by sector and by employer, and I think there's more work we can do. I've chatted to Omar about this before, around understanding the impact of that. But the 2-1 is still very prevalent. I think roughly 80% of employers stipulate a 2-1 as a barrier to entry. But actually, pre-university academics much less of a barrier than they used to be. So just to end up with, When we talk to employers, this is a copy of the IC Social Mobility Framework, and I won't go into massive detail on it. We built this with our employee members, those that are working a lot in this space. And I think the message I want to give is that actually, if you're going to tackle this as an employer, you need a long-term, relatively deep strategy. It is about who you reach out to, where you attract candidates from, the kind of selection processes that you run, how you develop people and retain them. The most advanced employers we work with have kind of, they might have got their recruitment pretty much sorted, but they're now looking at what happens 2 or 3 years down the line. So what they've realized is all those people they hired, for whatever reason, may have left, they may not have stayed. The culture. So it's about cultural change, it's about really embedding change within an organization, it's about upskilling the organization, it's about upskilling the candidates, it's monitoring, it's having constant evaluation throughout the process. This overarching strategy is really important. Just a final comment from me, I think despite all the difficulties of the pandemic, actually there have been some benefits that I can see now working through the system. The use of technology in recruitment and selection has changed again significantly through the pandemic. Lots of employers actually using more virtual technology. So that whole bit around marketing budgets, where they go to, lots of employers are telling me that actually they've been able to reach out to a much broader range of institutions and work with them in different ways than they did previously. So I think there's a lots of positive benefits from the pandemic that we're able to tap into. Over the next 12 months or so, we'll see how that sort of settles down and we end up in a whatever that new normal is. So hopefully that's given you a bit of a quick cook's tour into the world as we see it from the employer background. Any questions on that? If you want any more dive into the data, then please do just give us a shout. We'd be more than happy to share. Thank you very much.
And then our final panelist, we have Ugi Agbay-Green, who is an associate professor at Manchester Met University and also sits on TASO's theme working group.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you. So, as has been said, my name's Iwi and I'm a reader at Man Met University. I'm going to talk to you today about one of these targeted interventions that I'm leading. So we'll start. So basically, there was a call that was put out by UKRI last year. Some of you may have seen it. It was asking the sector to propose projects that were seeking to address access, participation, and progression issues, to address those issues in relation to so-called BAME students. I say so-called because I don't like the acronym, but I'm going to use it. It's the language of the sector, so I'm going to use it. So it put out the call, and to provide some background and context to the project that I'm going to talk about today, the driver for that call has really come from lots of reports that have shown that actually, often when people talk about BAME students at undergrad, they're talked about as being an underrepresented group. And actually they're overrepresented, 25%, just over 25% of undergraduate students are this so-called BAME group. And when you go through the student life cycle, right through to postgrad research, you'll see the numbers drop off a cliff, essentially. And once you get to postgrad research, it's 0.6% of the population are black students. Slight overrepresentation of Chinese students at just over 2%, but basically the BAME numbers fall significantly. And we have issues within the academy at the professoriat level, I can never say that word, where up until I think last week, we have 43 female black professors out of a total of over 22,000 professors in England. So there is massive underrepresentation in all areas of the academy once you get to that kind of postgraduate towards postgraduate research level. And that plays out also in terms of opportunities for so-called BAME students, in terms of grad jobs, on graduation, all the things that have been highlighted by the TASO report that we've seen today. So I wrote a bid. I was convinced to write a bid by Advanced HD, who I was doing some work with actually at University of Leeds, on degree award gaps at the time. And they approached me and said, oh, have you seen this this call that's gone out? We'd really like to work with you on a project. So I wrote a project which is colloquially known as Aspire, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. So it is a four-year research project funded by Research England and the Office for Students. And as I say, the call was specifically about addressing these issues into postgrad research. But actually, when I wrote the bid, and the programme is designed, so it actually has two pathways. So one is an employment pathway, and one is a research pathway. And they're not mutually exclusive, but the idea is that there will be some people that aren't ready for research, right, that don't want to necessarily do a PhD or a doctoral level study now, that might actually be more focused on graduate opportunities, but will take those research skills, those transferable research skills, into their grad jobs, and then possibly further on down the line, look to apply for postgraduate research opportunities. So this is the dream team, the A team, led by myself, as I say, and then my colleague Francis at Sheffield Hallam. And we're working with Advanced HE, who are doing the evaluation work. And Hannah is a quants specialist, and I might talk about some of the evaluation work that we're doing if I've got time. So we've got two patrons, the fantastic Alison Lowe. I'm a trustee for a mental health charity, and Alison, up until last year, was the chief exec. She is now deputy mayor for West Yorkshire for policing and crime. And then we have Professor Charles Egbe, who's the only black vice chancellor in England. So there are two patrons. So this is a really busy slide, I really apologise. I'm going to spend a bit of time talking about this slide, so don't worry. I apologise to those of you online who can't see it necessarily very well. But it's an important slide because it actually kind of gives you an oversight of the whole programme, which is jam-packed, essentially. So as you may have read on the slide previously, I said 6 months to the students, it's actually 7 months. So it's a 7-month programme. As I say, it's going to run for 3 years. This is a 4-year research project. The programme is really born out of, I would say, 20 years of research that I've done since, I know, I don't look old enough, working in higher education. So I used to be an accountant, and then I crossed over to the dark side about 10 years ago. And when I crossed over to the dark side, I was just really interested in how I could improve my practice. And that's where it started. So I did lots of little pilot studies around pedagogy and teaching practice. And then I had lots of students that were going out on placement. So I looked at how you could use technology to improve their experience, to develop skills, and to create evidence of what they were doing. And things just kind of snowballed from there, really. And it wasn't until I got to University of Leeds, naively perhaps, that I recognised what some of these equality gaps actually look like and the impact that they have on these students. And I had a group of black female students that I was teaching that came to see me and said, Evie, we really need some help. One of them was sitting on a 2-2 average. Long story short, she left with a first. And that was not about stuff that I'd done necessarily, but it was about things that I'd put in place that had helped her realise her potential. And some of that came from evidence that I'd seen in projects that I'd done previously, which some of the themes will run through what I'm going to talk about. But essentially, as I say, very much evidence informed from lots of work that I've done over the years. So I would refer to it as a 7-month programme of opportunity. It is split into 5 pillars. So the first 4 weeks, so each pillar is typically 4 weeks, we do personal professional development, which is very centred around purpose, values, strengths, capabilities, about completely obliterating the deficit narrative that follows black students. And we do a lot of affirmation work in those first 4 weeks, recognising diversity as a strength, etc. Second pillar is employment and employability. And we have all the traditional stuff that you would expect around CV writing, navigating recruitment and selection processes, transferability of research skills into academia or into industry. Lots of students that are very interested in community-based projects. So we had someone come in and talk about how you can set up a charity and working in the community, as well as the traditional employment skills, as I say, psychometric tests and things like that over the 4 weeks. 2 weeks of academic writing. So this is where the academic stuff started to build. And what I will say, actually, I'll come back to that because I'll lose my thread. 2 weeks of academic writing, then 4 weeks of quantitative research and 2 weeks of qualitative research. So they're the pillars that make up the structure of the programme. Throughout all of that, we have life coaching for the students, we have talking therapies, we have talk about race forums, really safe psychological spaces to talk about race. We talked about the Will Smith slap. We talked about black excellence and exceptionalism when we had the fallout from the black footballers that had missed the penalties. We talked about how society seems to afford compassion for people who are exceptional, but what is our everyday existence and what does that mean in terms of navigating various systems. So it's a real holistic programme of opportunity. They do a 30-hour micro internship, which is paid. So they all do an internship, and that internship might be with an employer, or it might be as part of a research group, or it might be a community-led project that they're leading, and some of them are working in teams to do that. We're also working with supervisors. So part of my vision is to improve practice of supporting black students. There's not that much in the literature actually about academic supervision of students in general, and black students have particular racialized needs that again isn't written that much about in that context. So we're doing some work with academic supervisors about supervisor approach, using lived experience to understand your position and what that means for your practice. So there's loads of work going on in this program. So on the left, you can see all the contextual factors stuff, which kind of refers back to what I was talking about. I could talk about this program all day. You probably get a sense of that. One of the fundamental reports that came out, well, there's two, the Closing the Gap report, which you may have seen from the UK, which highlights that if you are a black student with 3 A's, you are less likely to get a 2-1 or a first than a white student with 3 B's, which is shocking. And the other report, the Leading Roots report, which talks about, as has been reflected in the TASO report, how important actually graduate outcomes are in terms of then securing good employment. And again, we know that particularly for black students, as well as other racialized groups, they're coming into the academy sometimes with more and leaving with a lot less. So the work that I did at Leeds actually showed that proportionally black students were coming in with higher grades. I taught on the accounting and finance course. You needed 3 A's to get onto that course. And when we looked at the population of students within the university, actually black students were coming in with higher grades on average, which again counters this deficit narrative, the widening participation conflation sometimes that's accorded to these students, yet they were leaving with less in terms of graduate outcomes. So that's the contextual stuff. So the interventions, a lot of the stuff that I've been speaking about, but it's a real holistic programme. My view is if it's important, it goes in the curriculum. And so essentially I've created a programme that is a curriculum for 34 scholars who we have on the programme, that, as I say, very much informed by research that identifies specific needs for black students. So things like representation and role modelling and what that means in terms of symbols and stories and spaces that we have on the programme. Various mechanisms, as I've said, a big thing is community building. So as well as the talk about race forums, we have coffee mornings. We've had the business simulation game, which was the first face-to-face event that we held. We've had a student-led conference after the 4 weeks of quantitative research where they had posters for the very first time, a lot of them presenting at a conference, understanding what that means to talk about your research confidently with people who might be seeing it for the first time. So it's a real hybrid program. We have a combination of online workshops, face-to-face workshops, synchronous, asynchronous activity. And we've had people like Student Finance England come in and talk about finance, talk about access to money and what that means in terms of your barriers and opportunities moving forward. And what I should say is the two, I don't want to get too academic about it, but the two theories underpinning this programme is a work readiness framework that I came up with as a student when I was working at Leeds, which I might talk a little bit about in more detail later on. But the idea is that this embodies the capitals of things that give you value as an individual for somebody else to perceive that you are going to be successful in whatever context it is that you're going to go on into. So for these students, it's graduate employment or postgraduate research. So that underpins the design of the programme. And then we have Teresa Yosso is an academic who came up with community cultural wealth, which basically is a theory about challenging traditional notions of cultural capital. Because as I say, you know, for Black students, their culture should be something that is celebrated, not something that's just seen as making them different, but not valued or celebrated. Lots of outcomes, again, could bore you with all the outcomes that we're seeking to achieve, but it is a really integrated, holistic program of opportunity, and that's reflected in the outcomes that we're hoping to achieve. So summarizing, lots of things that we've done on the program that we continue to do, because we are at the tail end of the program at the moment, where they're being supported on their 6-week projects by academic supervisors, and then they'll do some poetry workshops right at the end. One of the big things that I've not really mentioned, as well as this community building and affirmation work, the very first thing I asked them to do was to upload a song that was meaningful to them and upload an artifact that said something special about them. And we played this playlist at the student conference, and what we'll be doing at the showcase event is creating a digital story of the programme and using those songs and those artifacts to tell the story, as well as some of the reflections by the students to kind of build that really. So that sense of community and pride in who you are is really, really important. Obviously, this hard, tangible stuff that I've got to show the funders we've achieved, right? So one of the things we've managed to do, Sheffield Hallam, who are the institutional lead, actually, they have very kindly provided 3 fully funded doctoral level places specifically for our scholars on the programme. Leeds Trinity, the attachment being Professor Charles Egbu. They are providing 3 doctoral level opportunities, all fully funded, that are ring-fenced for our scholars. And this is the work that I'm trying to go out and do as well, is to create these opportunities that are positive action targeted interventions specifically for these underrepresented groups at this particular level. So the work continues. So just finally, coming back to the work readiness stuff, and the outcomes. I just put this slide on. You can't see the text. I can't see this text. But I just wanted to highlight the fact that, for me, when we talk about targeted interventions, and I know we've spoken a lot in the report and has been said about the real need to understand the needs of different groups, and different groups need different things. So I am often challenged as to why I've written a programme that is specifically for Black people. And my counter to that is always the evidence, right, that I've shown in the research that I've done. But it isn't about creating jobs, it's about creating opportunities. And it's about ensuring that whatever we do with our students is impacting on their life opportunities. I get very frustrated sitting in meetings. I love evidence, I love data, but these are people. And we're talking about the ripple effect that these gaps have on their access to capital, to wealth, the intergenerational wealth, those opportunities for people's children. And so this is really personal work for me, as you've probably gathered. And that feeds into how the programme has been designed, because I completely understand the need for hard targets and measures. I'm an accountant, right? I get it. But I also know that we have a responsibility to make sure that people are in an environment where they can do the best that they can do. And this is what this programme is about. So I think I've probably used up my 10 minutes, but thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think you missed, there were some compliments about your research in the chat box that popped up when you were talking. I'm going to use Chair's prerogative and ask a quick couple of questions before handing it over to the audience. Just to check, is the mic working for online attendees?
I'll check.
Okay, great. It is on. It looks like it is on. I just got weird wires. Iwi, question for you, because you kind of hinted at it at the end. But one of the themes or kind of, challenges that cropped up in the consultation was around the extent to which institutions should be providing targeted versus universal support. So I totally agree that the kind of evidence, the data analysis speaks for itself when you see the gaps that kind of emerge in relation to employment outcomes. But I'd love to hear more about the challenges you might have experienced in terms of getting your kind of program off the ground, and also how it might have been received by students as well.
Can everyone hear me okay? I'm not sure is that working for everyone? Brilliant, thank you. Okay, so I might get into trouble for saying this, but I am always getting into trouble, so it doesn't matter. I think one of the reasons why I was able to get this project up and running and off the ground is because actually things didn't happen the way they were supposed to. So by that, I mean, universities are notoriously difficult places to embed change quickly. And had a very short lead time from when the embargo was lifted to actually delivering the programme, given the timescale of the programme. And because I don't work at the lead institution, I wouldn't say I was given free rein, but I was perhaps given a bit more freedom to do things than I ordinarily would have been. And that created an opportunity for me, basically, to get it done. So I definitely think there is something that can be a little bit restrictive about how universities operate and work that can prevent targeted interventions happening maybe as quickly in response to the data as you might want. I think there is definitely a challenge around managing resources and designing programs such as this at scale, for sure. But I also get very, very frustrated by going to various conferences and hearing people do very similar things at different institutions, when for me there's like some great synergies that could be created and some great collaborations and a broader impact actually for a wider range of students potentially to be achieved. So I think there's something again about the competition and the unwillingness sometimes of people to collaborate for the greater good, if I can put it in those terms. One of the really big challenges for the programme, I always have sustainability in mind when I'm thinking about the activities on the programme. This programme currently has 34 scholars and the target was 30 for each programme. So that's great, 90 students, but that's not going to revolutionise the sector, right? So it's, for me, it's been thinking about beyond the 3-4 years, how does this then become something that institutions can adapt and adopt to their own context, or maybe we can broaden it out for and roll it out for a wider group of universities. One of the great things, I will shut up in a minute, one of the great things is that I am going to do a version of Aspire sort of in-house within the university, because one of the things I didn't say, Aspire, the 34 scholars that come from lots of different universities, some of whom aren't attached to a university. So it would be great to do it in at an institutional level and evaluate that and take some of the learnings from that and maybe collaborate with others along the 4 years. It's a long, very winded answer to your question. I'm very sorry.
One final question. Yeah, it's just going to explode in a second before I hand over to the floor. Probably directly at you, Stephen, but as I set out at the start, we didn't include kind of employer-related activity that happened outside of HE within the report. But I'd love to hear if there are any examples of, I think, particularly employers working alongside HE providers to deliver programmes to address some of this stuff that come to mind, putting you on the spot slightly.
That's actually quite a difficult one to answer, because one of the things we tend to do about
the graduate labour market is that we generalise around it, and I've done it today because that's how we do it, it's how we communicate, was actually it's a series of very different labour markets. Every institution is a slightly different labour market, if you think about it in that way. And also employers, not only across sectors, but actually within sectors, all behave very, very differently. And I think one of the challenges that I think about with the ISE is actually how do we get all these great practices and these great programs, understand what's working, and help employers that aren't doing so much invest in those kind of activities and the time, and also get employers, because employers still can be a bit transactional. At the end of the day, they're after hiring people. And I think one of the challenges we have, which is the end result for an employer is who comes out at the end of the funnel, who they hire, where of course an institution is interested in all its students. And there's a tension there that we don't talk about enough. We've got to find a way of managing those transitions. But in terms of actual the individual practice, what I would say, it's those employers, that last complicated slide had, it's those that do it all, in a sense that they are thinking about the culture within the organisation. They are thinking about all the kind of some of the interventions you make. It's actually, it's doing that work from even pre-university and working with students all the way through, so it results in employment outcomes. I think we are getting there with employers. Those who just think, well, if I change my brochure, if I change my selection process, actually that doesn't do anything to shift the dial. So it's those longer term interventions are the ones that make a difference.
Wow, thank you. I'll stop being greedy. Any questions from the floor here in the room? Yes. Sorry, I can't do the mic as well.
Thank you. My question is for Stephen. So when you talk about employers that use contextualized data in the recruitment process, what data specifically are we talking about, and how do you think that this transforms opportunities? I'm thinking in particular for students from lower socioeconomic backgrounds. I'm happy to talk more, but I think so.
So you get different kind of behaviors, actually. So there's organizations out there like Rare Recruitment, Upreach, that have, you know, commercial or slightly commercial products that employers use. And of course, you also got the range of employers that, you know, that just don't look at academics at all in terms of the data. But the ones that use contextualized data, most of them look at actually the schooling background. So what were the grades that the student got in relation to the school that they went to? Did they outperform? They look at things like first generation, free school meals. What most of them tend to do is they look for flags. So it's not one particular measure that says, you know, we should look at this candidate where we might not have done usually. It's two or three flags. And if those candidates are flagged, they will then pull them into their selection process. And from talking to employers, what they tend to say, it's an additive process. By that, I mean, because some of the people that argue against contextualized data, or the kind of Daily Mail argument against it, is that's, you know, excluding people. But actually what most employers say, it's about who you would look at in addition to who you would normally look at. So it's employers broadening their talent pool. And there's different behaviours from different employers, but that's generally the rule of thumb. They look at a number of different measures, and they look at those where there's more than one flag, because we all know that one particular measure on its own is not particularly useful. And the one thing I will say as well is actually a lot of the work that's done on what employers use actually comes from academia. It's initiatives that were pioneered at Oxbridge, Bristol, etc. So they've taken that kind of understanding of the work that universities have done and applied it to the employment sector.
Thank you. Any questions from? Oh, I'll hand over to you, and then sorry. No. And then we'll ask anyone online as well.
Thank you, Stephen. Sorry, if I could just kind of follow through with that. Recruiting a diverse, more diverse range of young talent is just the first step. I'm just interested how organisations like your members are going about understanding the next generation coming through. Because once you've got this new diverse talent in, if they're still going into the old kind of organisation that hasn't changed in any way, within about 24 months they're going to be disillusioned and go. So have you got a view on that? Are you? Thank you.
Thank you. I think this is getting into the detail of your last slide, right?
Yeah, and not everybody's there by any stretch of the imagination, because there's, as I said, there's still some employers we've got to convince to engage in this whole issue in the first place. But it's interesting. So I'm going back now 4 years ago, and I was at a global law firm, and their head of people globally said, we think we pretty much, you know, not totally fixed the recruitment bit, but we know where we're at to with that. But she said, what we realised, we looked around, and three or four years later, everybody we'd hired had kind of left. And they didn't all leave in kind of like, I'm throwing up my arms, I'm leaving in disgust. So it was kind of a gradual realisation for this employer. And it's all of a sudden you realise, and that's where you get into issues of the culture in the organisation. You know, does somebody have to conform to fit that organisation's? And if they don't want to or they can't, do they then gradually leave? So I think lots of employers are now looking at inclusivity. Some of the things you talked about, your way about translating that to the employment space, making people feel recognised, valued, all that kind of work. And again, that's why that cultural bit of employees is really important. You've got to think about what the working environment is. And that's where the early talent diversity debate, that's where that segues very neatly with the broader organisation approach. So if you look at a typical employer, actually the recruitment bit is a very small part of what an employer might be doing. Right across the piece, so it's making sure those two things connect.
Thank you. We've got questions from the online.
Yeah.
If you shout them out, I'll repeat them.
So, first one, how does the Aspire program go
about taking it? And then there's actually a second one as well, asking how they targeted voters to ensure it reached the Asian target group. Right, I'll just repeat them in case. Do I need to do that? It's the online, yeah. So, two questions in one, difficult task, relating to the Aspire program and the extent to which it sits alongside the curriculum or is additional, and how you also went about targeting Black students as well as part of the process. Over to you.
Thank you. Okay, so the Aspire program currently doesn't sit in any of the program or within the curriculum. It is seen, I suppose you'd say, as an extracurricular activity. When I did the expression of interest event in the December to recruit for the end of January, I had just kind of promoted through my own networks, and I was 1 week into my job at Manchester Met when I had to turn around and say, by the way, you know the job you recruited me for? Well, actually, it might need to change a little bit. So that was an interesting conversation, but it also meant that I didn't know anybody internally, so I didn't have like a high level promotional strategy. I did just use my networks to kind of, you know, drum up some interest. So I did an online expression of interest event, as I say, which was attended by not only Black people. I had a group of Asian students or people who were in attendance as well, and had to obviously sadly tell them that this opportunity wasn't for them, right? And they were quite upset about the fact that it wasn't, because they thought it was great, and they said that they needed something like this as well. So I do think it's a program that can be adapted for different groups, but I do think that kind of tailoring and targeting within the program is really, really important to get the impact that's needed. As I said, we've got 34 people, and because it was such a short lead time, I was like, what am I going to do if we don't recruit anybody, right? I spent all this time writing this program, we might not have anyone do it. So I left the recruitment criteria quite broad. Basically, you just had to have finished level 4 at university, which presents a whole range of issues around how you pitch it and the levelness, as you can imagine, because we've got third year undergraduates right through, she won't mind me naming her, to lovely Ingrid, who's in her late 50s. And has a creative business and wants to do a PhD, right? So we've got a whole breadth of people, and we've got some international students, some UK students. Moving forward, I'm not sure, because that strategy was quite emergent because of the circumstances, and maybe do I need to be more purposeful moving forward in targeting? I'm not sure, actually, because one of the things I didn't talk about was early outcomes have been amazing. So we've got someone who's already secured fully funded PhD at Man Met that she went for last year, didn't get, but has got this year and has put it down to Aspire. We've got a number of people who started the program who thought employment was what they wanted. I want to go into a grad job, who actually want to do an MRes now, Masters in Research, to go on to do a PhD. So a lot of it has been about raising aspiration, but also about them knowing that actually it's okay to not want to do a doctorate, but it should be a choice. It shouldn't be that you think you can't do it, so you don't do it. So I would want it to be in curriculum, because like I said, if it's important, it should go in the curriculum. 7 months would be really hard to shoehorn into a 3-year program or 4-year degree. So we'd have to think a little bit about that, but definitely, as I say, would love to broaden it out and have other groups have access to the program as well.
Online or the room? Yes.
I was just going to say, Uwe, following on from the question about how you recruited students, who did you work with in order to deliver the program? It seems like a lot of work, and I can't imagine that you were just doing it by yourself. I hope not, anyway. So who did you work with in order to deliver, and how did you recruit your peers and colleagues to do that with you?
Thank you very much. Thank you for the question. I did pretty much write it myself. And obviously with support and help from my co-lead on the project at Sheffield Hallam. But in all honesty, the delivery of the project has been completely reliant on people that I know, that, you know, I've been part of my network built up over the 20 odd years I've been working in higher education, people you meet at conferences, people you know in your day-to-day, people who you know are brilliant and actually understand what the program's about. There were a few people who I recruited to deliver on stuff. So for example, Atos came in and did 2 sessions, one on psychometric testing, one on navigating recruitment selection processes, kind of simulation type stuff. And I didn't know her beforehand, but I'd been invited to an EDI event at Atos where we'd met and had been chatting. But that was quite an exception, really. Most of the people that delivered on the programme were people, as I say, that I knew sort of from my broader networks. There is some stuff maybe that could be changed a little bit moving forward, but I'd say broadly speaking, from what the scholars have told us, it just seems to have been brilliant, in all honesty. And I do think the role of data and evidence has been really, really important. Really important in doing that. And there's a lot of appetite to do this in the sector. I've just been very fortunate to be able to get some money to do it. And I have worked ridiculous hours to do it, but it's been worth it. But it's not sustainable. It shouldn't be the case that you have people like myself who are really motivated to do this work that invest in it and then deliver something. We should be doing this in a more systematic, resource-supported way. And of course, Advanced HE, as I say, are leading on evaluation work, so hopefully that will help make those improvements that we need moving forward to perhaps deliver this at scale moving forward. We'll see.
Thank you. I might ask another question to everyone. I'd be really interested to get kind of everyone's thoughts on what the HE sector could do or should do more of to address inequality gaps. I recognise that our report kind of flagged a lot of gaps in the research and evidence base, and I'd love to hear kind of what collectively we should do to kind of address those gaps and change outcomes. I'm going to hand over to you, Uwe, again, work backwards, if that's all right.
Oh, how long have you got? I mean, I think I've touched on it already, and, you know, I bang the drum about this all the time. I think I really like Taso's approach in the theory of change stuff. And obviously, you know, you talked about standards of evidence and how important that is as the evaluation work. I think as a sector, we're pretty bad at that, to be fair. And I think that within the processes and the inputs stuff, that we need to be centering students as partners
and recognizing that actually the people in the room making the decisions about how to address these equality gaps are not the people being represented by these equality gaps. And so it's really important to center that student voice in those conversations and to understand from that position, what is it that is going to mitigate systemic barriers? Because this is about a system that doesn't work for particular groups, works for some, doesn't work for others. So for me, the primary focus of work in the short term should be about supporting those groups to better navigate the system, right? Which is kind of what we try to do on Aspire. I would love to change the system, change the world, but I can't. Even I recognize my own limitations. So as a sector, I think that should be the short term focus, is like, how do we make it better or easier for these groups to navigate the system and do that in a very targeted, systematic way? And then we can focus on the longer term stuff, which is about trying to eliminate, mitigate, remove these barriers.
So somebody, I guess, who, well, am I in the sector or not? I'm outside the sector, really, but with a foot in, I guess, is the way to describe it. So I think there's a great opportunity that we're still not capitalising on yet. And that is, and I've seen some moves in this direction, and that's when we look at the widening participation agenda. There is congruence with the employer agenda. We're on the same page, or should be, around it. And I think we've got, I'm trying to do this while balancing the mic, because I visualise it. This isn't going to work, is it? It's that knitting together. I'll do it quickly. It's that knitting together so we get the transitions through. So I think that's something we haven't cracked yet. It's how do you connect the WP agenda with the employer's agenda? Because it is broadly the same agenda. And it's how do you knit the two together so we get students exactly system-wide, systemic, as they move through education and then transition into that world of work. It's how do we connect those two? Because I think we all generally want the same outcomes. Some of that will be data, it will be driven by graduate outcomes, you know, despite all its flaws, but I still think we're not doing very well at connecting it within institutions, that employer and WP agenda. So that's where I think we should be heading.
Thank you. So I think currently there are a lot of interventions that are really undertaken by the sector, as we said. But these interventions are not evaluated in ways that are like causal. So we at TESO work on like a range of methods who can be from your RCT that a lot of people know about, but also small end methods that can be used when you have a smaller group of students, but you still want to have a very rigorous evaluation of the program. So I really think that would be interesting to look at what is already being done and how we can evaluate it better in order to get the evidence base, because providers think that they know what works, but actually when looking at the evidence base, it's pretty weak and it doesn't have a lot. So I think if we have some budget to put into evaluating the programs that are being run currently in very rigorous way, that would already be an improvement. And then we can look at different, more targeted, but also more innovative programs, and then run them and then evaluate them. That would also be interesting. I think both need to be done in combination. So we can have, hopefully in the next years, a more, a broader range of evidence to look at when designing those interventions.
Thank you. I just wanted to come back to your point, Stephen, actually. It was that is something that emerged from our research as well, where it's not just about involving employers in the process, but actually the teams that are responsible in many institutions for delivering employability interventions are different to WP teams and possibly different again to evaluation teams. And so actually kind of drawing together those different expertise and individuals within kind of one program seems to be really important. We possibly have time for one more quick question from the floor, if anyone has one that they're kind of desperate to ask. Oh, Omar.
You need a mic. Yeah. No, it's good. I'm Omar, the director of TESO. I thought the point that we made about working with multiple institutions and how there's lots of providers doing similar stuff, but they aren't really working together. I was wondering if you had any reflections. I know you said that, you know, you were a little bit outside, but you know, how can we better get providers to work together maybe even in terms of data sharing or in analyzing similar-ish types of projects from an evaluation perspective. But yeah, any lessons learned there, I suppose, in how to design evaluations for maybe multi-provider projects?
I think that, well.
Everyone.
Well.
Okay. Anyone want to go first?
It's difficult because I represent the larger employers, you know, which there's a relatively small number, and there's a danger they get all the airtime because most graduates don't go into those jobs. You know, in a sense, there's a bit of minority support, so they've got to be a little bit careful around how this plays out. But it goes back to that previous thing we were talking about. You know, the university career services have the employers, should have. I think historically the WP teams have not been connected, though I think it's getting better. So it is connecting those and those teams together. And I just think it's doing a lot of hard work at a local level. Exactly as you said, all that hard work you've had to do off your own back. Employers and institutions need to invest proper time and money in this because you can't do this on the cheap. You can't do it with a quick system solution. There's not one little bit of tech that somehow will magically. And sometimes I think we chase those kind of solutions when the reality is time, money, effort is what's needed. Not sure that answered the question.
So, as I say, I now work in Manchester, and about 60% of our students, when they graduate, will work in the Greater Manchester area. And I know, having worked at a Russell Group university and a couple of post-92 universities, about the attraction piece with graduate employers, particularly larger employers, although thankfully, as Stephen's alluded to and shown today, that's kind of changing. But I mention that because I think there is a real opportunity for universities like the one that I work at to be working in partnership with SMEs, the SME market, a lot more, because there's lots and lots of opportunities in those markets, and there's lots of benefit that the graduates could bring to that market and to those firms that aren't being leveraged at the moment. And, you know, I hear that SMEs are crying out for accountants, for example. Yet, as Stephen says, you know, if you go into accounting, most of the grad accounting trainees come from humanities. They don't come from accounting and finance courses, right? But for our students, there may be an opportunity, as I say, to actually go and work in the SME market. If they want to then go into professional services, it might be something they do later on the line, down the line, when they've picked up, you know, some experience, etc. So I think there are opportunities that could be leveraged that could bring benefits, tangible benefits that aren't being realised at the moment through collaboration and partnerships with perhaps people that haven't been identified, but actually could create great impact for our students.
Thank you. Again, I'm seeing out of the corner of my eye compliments popping up for lots of interesting presentations. So thanks to everyone for presenting today. Just to kind of close with a kind of quick comment on what TESO are doing next. As you'll have seen from our report, one of the challenges that we faced in our work was trying to kind of generate information from the sector in terms of the evaluations that they are conducting of kind of more emerging interventions or kind of more innovative practice. And so our next step is we've just undertaken a commissioning round and we'll be looking to conduct pilots of programs that are kind of more targeted in order to build emerging evidence and support kind of more targeted programs, get to the point in which we might be able to generate type 3 evidence. So that's the next stage in our employability program, but we'll also be kind of looking to expand on that over the next year. But just to close, let's all kind of join together in a round of applause for our panelists who great. Thank you.